We have an insufficient supply and overwhelming demand growth, which are the strong foundations for why I believe in the National Infrastructure Bank. We're talking about fiber and broadband investment. To meet future needs, the United States needs an estimated $130 to $150 billion into fiber infrastructure investment. Okay, and that's a huge number, but I want you to think about what this is going to do. So what I'm focusing on tonight is extending fiber deeper into communities. So we call this deep fiber into communities as a critical economic driver. So even though we're making this investment, what is our ROI? Okay, what is our rate, our return on that investment? So today, the bulk of traffic carried by those wire broadband networks, most of us, we're on video, right? So we use it for video, for entertainment, and for information purposes. Streaming video and new forms of immersive media, such as virtual reality, are at the tips of expanded technologies that we'll see with this investment in broadband and what cannot be imagined, but actually actualized, okay, by users and communities. What we do know is fiber to the home and businesses will be necessary to support the future of content delivery, okay? That's where we are right now. In order for us to compete globally and also to be able to build where we are in this country, we have to work on content delivery. And that's going to include videos, yes, gaming, AR and VR, which is our virtual reality, yet to be invented new content and application platforms. So if you think about what Windows did, you know, to the DOS, where we had to type in DIR:// really showing my age here, right? But yes, what did Windows do? What did that technology allow? Think of everything that birthed out of Windows, okay? That is what we're talking about, is we're talking about an expansion like that, not with computers, but with fiber and broadband investment. So just to talk about some of that, we're talking about autonomous vehicles and drones. So I know some of you are like, I'm not with the drone thing, but you got to think about autonomous vehicles as we talk about our society aging and people finding it more economic to live at home rather than going in nursing homes. We saw what happened with COVID. Autonomous vehicles allow people not only to have delivery service, which we're all enjoying, right? Pulling up, they put the deliveries in the back, the groceries in the back of your car, or they're delivering to your home, but autonomous vehicles. And so when you think about, oh my goodness, so that's what I'm sure you're thinking about, like Jason and myself and other people that represent working people, we're getting rid of drivers. No, we're going to work on developing new jobs that will build building those vehicles or commanding those vehicles from a center. And what it also means to the growth of what for people that are disabled or unable to get out their homes. We're talking about edge computing, augmented reality, and virtual reality. These are things that aren't just, so you can't just think of what we saw playing video games and that. We're talking about you actually having a virtual reality visit with your doctor, possibly. We're talking about things we've only imagined, being able to see other countries through virtual reality, being able to visit and do things and say, oh yeah, I would love to visit New Zealand because I went on a virtual reality tour and this is where I want to go and stay. So there are things we're not even being able to think about yet because we're not there until we are able to make a full investment into broadband and fiber deployment. So digital collaboration tools. I want you to think about both our rural and urban communities, what farmers will be able to do. And I'm not just talking about corporate farms. I'm talking about people that we know that own farms still in local communities, that what they'll be able to do as far as helping maybe a farmer in Africa, and what we can do as far as building out irrigation systems or getting new ideas and new development. This is what we'll be able to grow, not just in our corporations and businesses, but with new technologies, allowing people that are already doing this work to expand beyond just the little confines or folds of where they are as far as whatever. And so it's so vast to think about whatever their professions are, or whatever their skill set is. We also have physical robotics and automation. So I know this is another one where people think of iRobot, but I want you to think beyond that, okay? A lot of things we have already are doing this. So think about your Alexa actually being able to do more than most people think to spy on you, right? Lord, if your Alexa could actually have your dinner started before you get home, or remind your mom to take her medicine, or call the automated car and remind them to take your mom to her doctor's appointment, or your dad or your loved one. There are a lot of things we have to think about that technology just isn't for selfish innovation, but it actually allows us in society to be able to take care of ourselves and each other. The other thing is robotic process automation or intelligent automation, advanced cyber defense. That is something that's, look, we can talk about this all day long. How many of y'all have been received an email that your information has been stolen or may have been hacked? And this is what all the stuff you have to do. Part of that, because we don't invest into what we're talking about, broadband, that's one of the things we'll be able to do is to really protect ourselves cyberly. And we saw what also happened with elections. I don't even have to go into that. Blockchain, cloud computing, we're just right here when we're talking about what we're able to do with the cloud. There is so much more to develop and move beyond. And I would like to add that when you think that only a couple countries are actually using the technology, why the rest of us aren't on board when we think about the United States of America is because we don't have the technology to plug into what always is going on and also build beyond that. And okay, this is going to include hybrid and multi-cloud, which is awesome. AI, natural language processing, computer vision, 3D printing that's already there but has not went too much farther because we don't have the capacity to do that in quantum computing. So let's think about this in terms which I kind of hinted on for our community. We can build a stronger education system, and we can also get the chance to reform our workforces to not just be technologies or being able to, I would say, moving more into the greener jobs that are going to preserve our communities and our earth for generations going forward, also expanding the growth of hometown farms and not just corporate farms, which we've seen what that's done to local farmers. We want to be able to do that. How do we make our farmers more business-like and new businesses in rural communities? So the biggest thing I want you to think about here is the spinoff of when we invest fiber, deep fiber, into communities where that is needed, how they're able then to expand people to come and visit smaller towns and see what they have going on, how we're able then to have automated cars and a way for people to get to those areas, and also to grow and develop businesses, which feed into the tax base, which when we talked about that 130 to 150 billion, right? How do we take that billion and actualize it into community after community after community? When we're talking healthcare, we're talking jobs, we're talking about new industries, we're talking about a potential for growth that many of us haven't even imagined. So on my side, and when it comes to broadband, we are just at the tip of what we're going to be able to do if we were really to make a true investment into broadband, not just in deployment, but into people's lives, everyday people's lives, and building out into the future. So thank you for my presentation, and I hope I made you a little more excited about broadband.